Okay, so thank you. And today we will speak on the Jewish lay space. Maybe I will use part of this blackboard. As yesterday, we will denote by D0 the Jewish lay space. And I recall that the norm of F square will be, in that case, B0 square plus the sum of N mod of BN square. This is not exactly the definition of yesterday, but we will adopt this definition if, of course, F of Z has the expansion like this. And so we have as a reproducing kernel with this definition of the norm, it's 1 minus logarithm of 1 minus A bar Z. So logarithmic term shows up, so the behavior of the reproducing kernel is quite different from the Hardy case. And well, T will be C phi, and I will abbreviate A sub n of t, the nth approximation number of t, as A sub n, and I will have an eye on the following parameters, beta minus 1 of t, but beta minus, sorry, is limimph of A sub n to the 1 over n, and beta plus is the same thing with limimph soup. And, well, maybe I continue in the more visible part of the... So we have this inequality, trivially. And I just want to observe that the fact, for example, that we have the strict inequality from the left is meaningful because this means that A sub n cannot have a super exponential decay. See, it has to be bigger than that with some R positive. And similarly, beta minus 1 less, beta plus, sorry, less than 1 means that A sub n is less than R to C, R to the n, where R is less than 1. And we will be, will more precisely compute these parameters. So I have still my four questions: boundedness, compactness, shatterness, and rate of decay. And here, if I begin with boundedness, that is to say, I have my function phi from d to d, which is analytic, whereas it was the composition operator associated to this function was automatically bounded in the case of the Hardy space and as well in the case of the Bergman space. Here it's a big deal, and first of all, you see, if C phi maps D naught to itself, so of course phi, which is C phi of the monomial Z, has to belong to my space. This is an obvious necessary question, condition, and this is not always the case, because here we face a problem that H infinity is not included in D naught, and the converse is not true either. And even if I make some stronger assumptions on phi, for example, if I take phi of Z, the sum from 1 to infinity, I take a lacunary sequence, Z to the power 4 to the k over 2 to the k. Well, this function maps the d's to itself because the sum of coefficients is exactly 1. And it is not only bounded at the boundary, but Lipschitz 1/2. It's analytic Lipschitz 1/2. And it's easy to check that it does not belong to my space denote. So certainly this function, in spite of the fact that it is that it has some regularity, is not will not give a bounded operator. And now if I take a function which is slightly more regular, say Lipschitz alpha, so analytic Lipschitz alpha with alpha bigger than 1/2, then it's easy to see that phi belongs this time to denote, and as well, this is automatic, all its powers. So, and phi of phi to the power n is C phi of the monomial z to the n. So at least C phi maps polynomials to themselves, and we might naively think polynomials are dense in denote, so everything is in order. Of course, it's not the case. And you have examples, if alpha is less than 1, for which functions belonging to A alpha do not induce a bounded composition operator. So what we can say, so the situation is fairly complicated even for boundedness. So a sufficient condition is that phi is Lipschitz 1. You see what it means, Lipschitz 1, analytic Lipschitz 1. A second sufficient condition is that phi, the norm of phi n in denote is big O of 1. This has been proved by Kelle, Elfala, Schabanka, and Yousfi. This is a sufficient condition. What else? Phi is in denote and is injective. And this is useful even if it is obvious. And I mentioned a fourth condition. Phi is of that form, exponential of minus 1 over f, where f belongs to denote with a real part bigger than 1. So this might look a little bit strange. Indeed, in that case, C phi is in the Hilbert-Schmidt class, or if you prefer, in the Schatten class S2, which can be checked explicitly. You check that the integral of phi prime z square over 1 minus phi of z square square dA of z, which is a necessary and sufficient condition for being in the Hilbert-Schmidt class, is finite. So for symbols of that form, you check that condition. It provides you some interesting examples. But of course, this is quite, well, you have conditions which are quite at random in some sense. And let me now state a precise theorem, which is due to Zorbosca and Shapiro, and which gives you a necessary and sufficient condition for C phi to map denote to itself. Let us define a counting function. So n phi of w is the number of points z such that phi of z is equal to w. And then let me call mu the measure n phi dA, where A is the area measure in the, as in the previous talks. And then C phi maps denote to itself in a bounded way if and only if this measure mu is a Carlesson measure for the Bergman space B2. Which means exactly that because For B2, we have a Carlson embedding theorem, which is similar to the Carlson embedding theorem for the Hardy space, which tells you that this is the same as requiring that 1 over H2, the integral over a Carlson window W of psi and H, psi at the boundary of n phi of W, dA of W, is, big O of 1, and this in a uniform manner with respect to psi. So maybe I will prove that theorem because it is easy. And so, proof. Well, we look at, you remember that the norm of C phi is just, maybe I forgot to mention it, it's just the integral of the square of the derivative. And there is a constant term, if you permit, I will forget the constant term for simplicity. So this is the same as the integral of f prime of phi of z square, phi prime of z square dA of z. And here we recognize the Jacobian of the transformation phi, so that if I make the change of variable phi of z is w, this is nothing but the integral of f prime of w square. And then, as I make a non-injective change of variable, I have to take into account the questions of multiplicity. So here I have n phi of w dA of w. And I want my operator to be bounded, so I want it to be dominated, say, by the norm of f square, which is the integral of f prime of z square dA of z. F in the Dirichlet space. But now, f prime, let me call it J, runs over the Bergman space B2. So what we are requiring is that the integral of G of W square, say d mu of W with my notations, is dominated by the integral of, the norm of J in the Bergman space B2 square. This means exactly that the measure mu is a Carlson measure for the Bergman space B2, and as I said yesterday, this amounts to that. It was proved, I think, by Hastings, the version for the Bergman space. And so we have our theorem. By the way, you can see that if phi is injective, so this will be bounded by 1, indeed. And so we find again that for an injective symbol, we have a bounded composition operator. Okay. So as concerns boundedness, this is all that we can say. And let us go to compactness. Well, as you can imagine, here you just replace a big O of 1 by a small O of 1. This is not too difficult to prove. And but maybe also I should look at the reproducing kernel test of yesterday. If C phi maps denote to itself in a compact way, we know that we must have that, the norm of K phi of A over the norm of K A tends to zero. And then, if I use the explicit form of the kernel and test that condition, it's easy to see that it amounts to say that 1 minus phi of A is bigger than some constant delta sub epsilon, 1 minus E times epsilon for all epsilon positive. So this means that phi of A tends to 1 less rapidly than any power of 1 minus A. So this is much more demanding than the corresponding condition for the Hardy space. And for example, if you take for phi the lens map of yesterday. So we know that C phi acting on the Hardy space was very compact. It was in every Schatten class, and even its approximation numbers decayed like e to the minus square root of n. And here, well, it belongs to the note. This is easy to see. And moreover, it's injective. So certainly, C phi is a bounded operator from D node to itself. Is it compact? No. So C phi not compact on D node simply because it fails to pass that test. So it's not difficult to see because we have an explicit form for that. So in some sense, to be for a composition operator associated to a given symbol, it's much more difficult to be either bounded or compact when you are on the Dirichlet space instead of being on the Hardy space. This is the rule. And maybe I should make a remark. Can you still read here? You say neither yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So by the way, I forgot what I wanted to say. Ah, yes. The remark is if C phi from D node to itself is compact, one can prove that C phi is in all the Schatten classes of the Hardy space. So, being compact on D node implies a strong things on the Hardy space, and as we saw with the lens map example, the converse fails. And well, I will not prove that such result. So now I should speak of Schattenness, but maybe I will skip it for reasons of time, and I will pass to the main thing which I want to discuss, the rate of decay. And I will try to give both an upper and a lower bound. So I will first give a lower bound. So suppose that C phi maps D note into itself compactly. What can I say about this, its approximation numbers? I can say that, A sub n is bigger than delta times r to the n, or if you prefer, beta minus 1 is positive, with, of course, with r positive. So we cannot have a faster decay than an exponential decay. And Evgeny was asking me if we would use the Weyl inequalities which I have quoted yesterday. And well, we will give you will see the proof is simple. And first of all, I claim that without loss of generality, I may assume that phi of zero is equal to zero and phi prime of zero is different from zero. Why can I do that? Because I take any point, because I start with the point A such that the derivative at A is not zero. It exists because we excluded the constant functions, and then I change my symbol. I change it to the symbol. I think we saw such a transformation in one of the previous courses. Phi at the point phi of A, composed with phi, composed with big phi A, where in general phi u of z is an automorphism of the disk, which is given like that. The classical Möbius transformations, which are, by the way, involutive. So where they are defined, phi u is phi u minus 1. So now I do abstract nonsense of algebra. Psi psi is, C phi A composed with C phi composed with C, so it's difficult to write. And it's quite easy to see, simply because those functions are injective and analytic near the closed unit disk, that they induce a bounded composition operator, so D naught. That's what I used implicitly. And then I know that the approximation numbers of C psi are less by the ideal property, which I said yesterday, of the norm of C phi A, A sub n of C phi, and then the norm of this operator. So let us say a constant times A sub n of C phi. And now, of course, things are designed in order to have psi of 0 equal to 0, and then a simple computation, which I don't detail, but just the chain rule shows you that psi prime of 0 is not equal to 0. So if I am able to find a good bound, lower bound for this term, I will have automatically a good bound for this one. So that's why I can assume that without loss of generality. And so what? So I can suppose that. And then there is a fact that the eigenvalues of my composition operators under this assumption are given by the powers of phi prime of zero, any power, and be equal to zero, one, etc., and even infinity, if I want to. No. Okay, like that. And how do we prove that? I don't. We have the so-called Koenigs equation. We look at the eigenfunctions of the composition operators. We first solve that problem in the holomorphic functions on D, and then using the fact that C phi is compact on D naught, so it's a nice interaction, by the way, between operator theory and function theory. we can show that the functions which are solutions of that equation are in the Dirichlet space for every lambda like that. And so now, recall that I had said, as a consequence of the Weyl inequalities, we had that inequality. And let me set, for example, delta is phi prime of zero, which is strictly positive by my reduction. And then I get A1, An bigger than, delta to the 4, to the 2n square, that is delta to the 4n. So it's quite easy, as you can see, but the point is we have that lower bound. And now, well, maybe I will mention it without giving more details. With Daniel Lee and Luis Rodriguez Piazza, we proved that we can have that situation. Delta, epsilon sub n, whatever the sequence epsilon n is tending to zero. That is to say, thinking of the Magnitsky-Pelletier theorem, we have the lower part of that theorem. A sub n can decay to zero as slowly as we wish. And that's all. We have no, because of that obstruction, we have no upper bound. And maybe also I mentioned it here inside the remarks. If the norm of phi is less than 1, which in some sense is a trivial case. It means that the image of D under phi does not approach the boundary of D, then beta plus is less than 1. And maybe now I will state and prove, if I have the time, an upper bound. So here is the theorem. The theorem is the following. So set rho of H is the supremum for T between 0 and H of T minus 2, and also for psi of mod 1, the integral over this Carlson window of n phi dA. Then A sub n of C phi is less than a constant times the infimum for H between 0 and 1 of, I think it's square root of n, 1 minus h to the n, plus the square root of rho phi of h. So this is the theorem. An upper bound, maybe by lack of time I will not prove it. Observe that it contains the fact that if rho phi of h is a little o of 1, our operator is compact, and what I want to say is that, yes, for the proof, we can use Gelfand numbers, because after all, I have introduced several collection of S numbers, and here the Gelfand numbers plus, of course, the fact that our measure mu and phi dA is Carlson for the Bergman square, Bergman space, give you that that estimate. And it's not very difficult. And now, from that, suppose that rho phi of say H naught is equal to zero for some H naught strictly positive. What do we get from this inequality? We get that this term disappears. And here we have, this term can be forgotten, and we have as an upper bound 1 minus H naught to the n, that is to say we have an exponential decay. Okay? And it appears that, so exponential decay can occur only in that case, only if we have that that property. And it turns out to be the case, so we have a theorem which tells you that, beta plus is less than 1 if and only if we have star. But what does star mean? It means that all those integrals are zero, and indeed it means that phi cannot take any value in a small annulus between 1 and 1 minus h naught. You see, if I draw a picture, I have h naught here, and it means that if I take a point psi and a Carlson window here, this Carlson window is not seen by the measure mu, that is to say a phi of z cannot take any value in that annulus. So this is still equivalent to the fact that the supernorm of phi is less than 1 minus h naught. And it's just a heuristic, but it was the case. And I will, how much time do I have? Maybe I rushed too much. Let me see. Yeah. So as a corollary, we have the following. If epsilon n decreases to zero, we can find a function phi, a symbol phi, which is both in the disk algebra A of D, the disk algebra, and in D naught, and such that A sub n of C phi is less than C e to the minus n times epsilon n. And with phi of 1 is equal to 1. That is to say the supernorm is equal to 1. So how do we do that? The principle is the following. We first draw the image of the symbol. It will have a very pronounced cusp at the point 1. So here, I draw a picture like that, which is intended to be the image of the symbol. And if the cusp at the point 1 is very pronounced, this function rho phi of h will turn out to be very small. And can I realize such a picture as the image of a symbol? Of course I can, by the Riemann mapping theorem. So I can even do that with a function phi which is injective. So using that and that, we get that result. And okay. And but so the question remains: in general, what about beta minus one and beta plus? And here is the theorem which I will state now and maybe briefly discuss. The theorem is as follows. So, first, if the supnorm of I is 1, well, this is the same thing which I wrote on the right, then beta minus 1, beta minus, and beta plus are equal to 1. That is to say, I cannot have exponential decay, even if I can have nearly exponential decay. And second, and this is more related to the questions of capacity, which we have just heard of, if the norm of phi is less than 1, so set k, which will be the closure of phi of d. This is a compact set, and it is included in the open unit disk. And then beta minus and beta plus are equal, and they are equal to the exponential of minus 1 over a capacity which is not the capacity which Joachim mentioned. It's not the logarithmic capacity, it's the Green capacity. So C, Green, G for Green, C of K. So maybe I will just say a few words about this capacity, not on the proof. But, well, you can see that in this ocean of inequalities and estimates, we have an equality for one. So, and, well, to make the connection with the previous talk, so suppose we have a measure mu carried by k. A positive measure carried by k, and we attach to this measure its energy, which is the double integral. It's as before, the logarithm of something d mu of x, d mu of y. And in a previous talk, so the integral over k times k, in the talk of Joachim, we had that, 1 over x minus y. This was the logarithmic capacity. For the Green capacity, I put here E1 minus x bar y. This is the inverse of the pseudo-hyperbolic distance between x and y. And this is finite or not. And, if it is finite for some measure, we just take the corresponding equilibrium measure. So E, I will call it E naught, minimum of that. And if I proceed like that, it's a probability measure. So the integral of d mu is equal to 1. And, this is sometimes called, I think, the Robin constant of k. And the Green capacity of k is just 1 over this Robin constant, v of k. And this is what shows up in the statement. So a priori, there is absolutely no connection between approximation numbers of composition operators and capacities. And here, to prove that theorem, we rely on works of Harold Widom. which was mentioned, I think, by Nicolai. And indeed, this works. So the theorem works for more general spaces. So it works for, I am speaking here of D node, but it also works for H2, B2, and more generally, those weighted Dirichlet spaces, H omega, which is a set of functions F, such that this integral converges, F prime of Z square, omega of Z, dA of Z is finite, where omega is a radial weight, and which is integrable on the segment 0, 1. So in that framework, indeed, we prove the theorem. Having that expression allows you to make estimates on the norm, and if one wonders how those spaces enter this picture, of course, for the Dirichlet space, we just take omega equal to 1, and for the Hardy space, thinking of the Littlewood-Pellet identity, we take for omega the logarithm of 1 minus Z. Okay? And so this is, I think I will, let me see if I am, I think I will gain you 5 minutes for your lunch, and I will stop here.
Other questions for the speaker? Comments?
It's not known finally whether the arbitrary sequence tending to zero is a singular number of.
It's known that we cannot have arbitrary sequences because they cannot decay faster than geometrically.
Oh, yeah.
Geometric decay is the fastest possible. But we know that we can have arbitrarily slow decay.
Yeah.
But from above, not more than.
Arbitrary means that you can construct.
No, indeed. No, that we cannot. We cannot. Only the order growth. No. No, no. For the moment. Not as good as Peller.
Yeah. Because it's of interest, because if yes, yeah. So you can have a composition with a given modulus.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. But that we don't know.
Yeah. Other questions?
Maybe it's not true. Huh?
Maybe it's not true.
We'll thank the speaker again.